Hello, thank you very much for being here. Looking forward to this panel. We are talking about scaling into new markets, a how-to. When I'm walking around the exhibition hall, I'm thinking about this kind of thing, because of course there's so many people here in this giant pavilion, in this giant event, who are potentially in that position. They are looking to scale their business. So hopefully they'll leave this session with some real key takeaways. We've got 45 minutes just under. I can see the clock counting down as I speak. So what we're going to do is stop at about 10 minutes to go at the end for some questions. We've got the Slido. So if you've got the app there, which just explained, we'll see some of those questions coming up on the monitor. But if you want to be brave enough to put your hand up as well, we can get some live questions from the audience. And we want them to be really difficult, so they're real head scratchers for the panel. Speaking of which, we have Gilles Requena, the Chief Patent Research and Policy Advisor for the European Patent Office. Gilles, give us a wave so everyone knows who you are.
I'm very pleased to be here with you guys, and I'm sure we are going to have a very interesting panel. We do our best to make it interesting, for sure.
And Gilles is responsible for multiple units looking at technological trends and policies. Ali Niknam, who is CEO and founder of Bunk. Ali managed to get the first new European banking permit in over 35 years for his neobank, Bunk, which is now the second biggest in Europe with 12.5 million users. And Anais Monlong, who is a venture principal at Iris. Anais has been a VC investor for 5 years, investing mostly in deep tech with companies across Europe. So we want to start then with a sort of key question here, which is why scale up? If you're doing well at home and your business is going fine and things are not too stressful, why is it important to scale up? And more importantly, what's the right point to do that for a company?
You want to go?
Yeah, so I can start. So first of all, it's not an obvious, actually, decision. I think in many different sectors, the home market is often either specific enough or big enough for companies to develop there and have a key leadership position. I'm thinking, for example, of in the construction sector, which tends sometimes to be very national and is also big enough for very large companies to emerge. Now, expanding often means that you have a better defensible position. So if you're a leader in several countries, obviously you're more entrenched and a lot more interesting for potential buyers or partners. So that can obviously be an advantage if you're looking to create a large company. And also being in several markets enables you to get the learnings and see what is happening in one market, perhaps replicate some of the successes that you've had in one place. And all in all, in a market that tends to consolidate over time, if you look at what's happened in many sectors, you want to be in a position where you can potentially be the consolidator and not just the consolidated, if that makes sense.
Now, if I may, as an entrepreneur, your question sounds very weird to me, because I think as an entrepreneur, you have big dreams. The question should be the inverse. Why limit your dreams to a geography that someone someday in the past just put a line on and said, well, today we call this France or Germany or Netherlands, right? As an entrepreneur, I think speaking for myself, you create products for the betterment of mankind, and you want to deliver it as far and as wide as possible. So in the case of Bunk, we put users first in everything we do, and we try to make their lives easy. And we follow them. So we focus on digital nomads, and our user base is scattered all across the planet. And we look in how we can help them achieve their goals and their wishes as much as we can. So for us, the inverse is true. Like, why limit ourselves to local geography?
Is it also a sort of an ethos that you have as a business person? Is if you're not growing and expanding into new markets, then you're dying? Is that a truism as well?
I think, as with all of humanity, different people have different priorities. For us, for me at Bunk, it is really servicing our users. Now I know in the Netherlands, we have a saying. I don't know if there are any Dutchies in the room. Yes, a few. Well, doe maar normaal, dan doe je al gek genoeg. Calm down, because then you're already kind of too exciting. So in the Netherlands, it's not a necessity for you to grow in being an entrepreneur. But I do think things vary across people. And one of the most important things I believe an entrepreneur can do is stay true to yourself. Because if you start doing stuff on the basis of what others tell you to do or what others think is right, you will stray away from your strengths and then you'll surely lose.
So I suppose there are some businesses and some people that actually don't want to. They might decide they don't want to scale into new markets and they might want to stay and
local,
succeed
definitely.
Where they are.
And I know a couple of those entrepreneurs and they're perfectly happy to serve as a local community and they're proud of it and they know everyone and they offer excellent service. And, you know, who am I to tell them, no, but you can double your profit if you... Money is not everything, you know.
Well, I think that there is no one-fits-all approach. It depends, of course. Some technical fields are maybe more eager to grow because this is essential. If you are a local startup company in Latvia and you work for the car industry, there is no way that you cannot reach out at minimum the European market to develop. That's inherent. But again, going out means also more opportunities for sure, but more exposure. Exposure to competition, to litigation, and so on. And you must be really think through that and prepare yourself at the earliest possible stage before moving forward. Now also, even if you don't want to scale up and move away from your original market, in the digital economy, and I understand that the focus this year is on AI technologies, those services or products, they circulate out of your natural frontiers. And whether you will accept that, whether you want to keep control of your business, then you must also integrate that and make some business decision. Maybe you don't want to scale up, maybe it's not your natural development movement, but you must anticipate that and perhaps decide to be protected in some markets just to control your own primary area of development.
And I think also something very important in addition to what's been said is not all markets are created equal. So if you're from originally Switzerland, for example, companies there know that the country is fairly small, so expanding is something they think naturally about very early on in the creation of the company. You take a company in China or in the US, they have a much bigger initial market to address. And so obviously the trade-offs are going to be different. Why would you go to a geography that, for example, may be heavily regulated in your specific sector, whereas your home market may not be? If your home market is big enough, then you may choose to do an arbitrage where you stay in your home market rather than going to others. And some have been extremely successful as thinking international from the very start. Switzerland is a great example, but also Israel. For example, Israel thinks about the US as usually a priority expansion market very naturally and with great success.
If I may add another dimension. It's also a way to attract investment if you are a startup, depending on the level of market you have chosen. For example, we have measures that if you protect your innovation, new technologies, if you look for a pure national market protection, you will get some interest, but not that much. If you go for a higher market protection at European level and even international level, you increase your chance to attract investment for investors 10 times more. So, you have also to integrate that when you measure pro and cons, whether I should, that it's an important element for scaling up also for an investor perspective.
So what we've talked about, you're saying that it completely varies on the individuals and the companies, but is there any kind of, are there any benchmarks or key things that you should look for as a business person on the timing, on the when?
100%. So Bunk is my third big successful company. And my first one, called TransIP, today Team Blue, we decided to go international at a later phase. And because we decided this a couple of years in, it became very difficult. It was already a very Dutch company, the culture was very Dutch, the language was Dutch, all the code was, you know, commented in the documents were in Dutch. And so to change that DNA, to change that mindset, turned out to be very difficult. And for us to be successful internationally through that company was through M&A. So I decided not to make that same mistake with Bunk. At Bunk, we decided early on, look, our users are going to be international. The way to serve them best is by being where they are. So we are going to be international. So everybody's going to speak English. We're not going to speak Dutch. And then when the first international person comes, English, everything's going to be English. The language in which we communicate English, all the documents are English. We're going to prepare ourselves for international expansion. So I think if you want to go and if you want to be able to be competitive, you need to start at day one.
So really, you need to look at the idea of scaling up into new markets from the get-go. But what if you weren't potentially that ambitious at first? What would you be looking for as the moment of when to go? Because by the sounds of it, with the first one, perhaps you were a bit too late to try and
Definitely, expand. I was too careful. And imagine this is many years ago, back when startups weren't cool and we didn't have nice things like FIFA Tech and investors. So it's a different era. But so if you start out with a local mindset, I never succeeded. We tried a couple of times to enter into Belgium. We failed despite the fact that they largely have the same language. We went to Spain. We failed. Although our product was much better, our offering was much better, we failed. And so the way for us to succeed internationally was through M&A, by buying other local players and then combining the technology, etc. But we never succeeded on going abroad on our own strength, which we have with Bunk, by the way. So that's also nice to know.
Lessons learned.
Definitely.
Yeah, I fully agree. I think timing is key. If you don't follow the step in the right order, you can make it all wrong from the very beginning and you will lose some opportunities in the future. For example, if you want to protect your innovation, you file a patent at a local level, and then maybe you will discuss, you will turn around with some partners and so on. If you wait too much, you have 1 year, in fact, from the first filing to expand your protection internationally. If you don't do it by 1 day, you lose it. So your patents cannot be any more extended on other markets. So all those elements have to be integrated at the earliest possible stage. It's not always easy, because sometimes you are at a very early stage and you have not very clear prospect of what your future product can deliver. But I would say, as much as possible, you integrate that in your logic and business plan, even of the costs, because people say, okay, I start and then I will see if I get a bit of funding and so on, and then I will decide to extend and then. And all those decisions taken one after that can have a dramatic impact on your business plan.
And I think that is very true, and to add on what has been said, take a very specific example. Sometimes you may see traction in international markets that you may not expect, and I think listening for the signs and looking at these market timing indications that may be very subtle can be very helpful. So for example, one of the things that I didn't expect and actually discovered on the Spanish market, for example, is that if you have a product that has a little bit of a B2C angle or small business angle, there is a lot of word of mouth that can happen in Hispanic communities. So the language, because Spanish is obviously used in Latin America as well as in Spain, for this particular company, they were based in Spain and actually not even in Madrid, in a remote city in Spain. And they realized that actually a word of mouth had spread through Twitter on their product without them doing much about it. And then they looked at who the users were and they thought, oh, well, this market is interesting, Mexico, Colombia, let's see how we can hire people there, and especially some of these influencers on Twitter that we never asked for, but actually love our product. Let's get these guys on board.
That's a kind of accidental scaling, isn't it? I hadn't thought we'd go down that route, but let's stay there if that's okay. So if that happens to your company and you find yourself popular in a place that you didn't necessarily believe you would be initially, how do you maximize that?
Yeah, so I think it's not accidental, is not exactly the right word. I would say symptomatic. So it shows that in that particular market, there is an aspect or a need from customers that you may not have seen. And so what you should do is dig, find the data. Why are these people using you? Who are the local competitors? Are they coming from a local competitor? Are they coming from, let's say, a large corporation that promotes you in some way? And so the right thing to do is listen for those signs. And if you see that something is happening, just investigate. And this is often where you find that, you know, you will understand where it comes from, because obviously it must come from somewhere. And then on specifically finding the markets, and sometimes you may misread the signs or think that, you know, you've done the analysis in a specific market and actually you were wrong, then the key is still to get the data and say, okay, well, this is not working, we misread something, let's not invest and lose money, let's just take a step back, get the data, and then revisit your decision. I think that is key.
So it sounds like ambition is really important at the beginning, but also a little bit of caution. Have you seen examples of companies that have tried to scale into new markets too quickly and it's gone wrong because of lessons they hadn't learned?
Yeah, all the time. So
all
for
the time?
Yes. Well, you know, the great example, I think, is the US, right? The US, if obviously as a European company, many founders dream of the US with right reason. It's a huge market that has clients that tend to buy technology product perhaps more easily than some European countries. But sometimes they may hire typically the wrong salesperson or in the wrong city because they don't know where the communities are. So looking into the US market and specifically understanding where you should be, where the community is, where your customers are, is something that takes time. And then if you rush too much and you spend too much money, sometimes you realize that you spend it all and there's no result to show for it.
Yeah, I think also that unfortunately the experience shows that many startups learn about protecting their intangible assets the hard way, meaning that when they try to expand and enter into a new market, suddenly they are facing litigation and they realize that they should have done something else upfront, protecting, checking first. And you have many databases in the world. My organization, European Patent Organization, we are 39 member states covering all Europe, 27 EU member states, and we have partnership with a lot of patent offices, US patent office, Chinese patent office, and we have collected all data about patents. So we have a database of 150 million patent documents, the largest. It's freely accessible on our website. And just check it. It's covering all technical fields. At least you have an idea where if you want to enter into a certain country and so on, that there might be people here. Then it might affect your decision. You wanted to develop yourself. Maybe you will find a partner. You will find a license here and so on. So you can adjust. It doesn't mean that it's dead and there's nothing to do. But if you go a little bit naive and you say, I have a beautiful thing that the world is waiting for me, then the trouble might come too.
You know, we hear all these great stories and it sounds all very easy and almost a logical algorithm to go and scale up and et cetera. But here I'd like to quote Albert Einstein, who said, you know, the difference between theory and reality is that in theory things should work, but in reality they simply don't. And to answer your question, it depends on how you see failure. Like, for example, at TransIP, we went at it to enter Belgium, didn't really work. Pulled back, went at it in Spain, didn't really work. Pulled back, did M&A, today we're the third largest on the planet after GoDaddy and 1&1. So was that a failure or were those lessons to be learned up to ultimate success? You see, I think when it comes to entrepreneurship, ultimately, it all depends on your capacity to have a very clear vision, a strategy to reach that vision, and the ability to cope with all of the crap that comes up in real life, to deal with it, learn from it, overcome it, and get to the point you want to.
I was going to say, you say that it sounds easy and like an algorithm. To me, it doesn't. It sounds like a lot of hard work. But let's take a step back and go back to the how-to. So I've got a company and I want to scale into a new market. We've already touched upon this with the licensing and the patents. What should my first steps be? Research, I imagine.
If you have a company and you want to scale, then you're already too late.
Can you explain what you mean by that?
Because when you start that company, you should already have a clear vision in mind in what you aspire to achieve. If you think about, I'll give you an example. And I'll ask the audience a simple question. Maybe the Dutchies will know. Who here has ever heard about a company called Hives? Okay, a couple of Dutchies in the room. Goedemiddag. Who here has heard about Facebook? Exactly. So Hives was a Dutch company that effectively did the same thing that Facebook did. They started growing beyond what they imagined. They weren't prepared. They started growing in South America, in America. That costed them a lot of money for, you know, infrastructure, etc. And so what these people did is they cut off their worldwide growth to save money. And as a result, today, unfortunately, because I know the people involved are great people, but unfortunately, Hives doesn't exist anymore, and obviously Facebook is one of the four biggest companies on this planet. So, you know.
So what's the lesson there then? Is it that they expanded too soon, or they didn't have enough money, or they gave up too early?
Their vision didn't align with the potential of their company.
And what are those people doing now, just out of interest?
I wouldn't know. I think they started another company. I don't know.
I'm sure they're doing fine.
They drink beers with me every now and then on the canals.
So they're fine. They're
so that's
great.
Good.
Yeah. Okay, so it's research, it's ambition.
And perhaps on a more, let's say, positive note, on the B2B market, things can be fairly easy. For example, if you have a large customer in one country and you expand with them to other countries, that can be a very practical way to come to a new market. And if you have a large enterprise type of customer, this works often very well. And often the research is sort of outsourced with your customers because they tell you, hey, I tested this in this market and I liked it. I have the similar problem in, I don't know, Spain. Why don't you try building this with me in Spain? The other thing that can work is when you have, it depends on the market, but when you have a market where people tend to know each other, so they have like governance bodies or trade associations that are European-wide or even worldwide, then if you're part of these associations, you can benefit from the international connections in that community. So again, on the building space, for example, this is a space where they have a lot of those international bodies. So if you're a member or part of that community, really helps. You should still plan in advance, and you should still, you know, have a vision for your company if you want to scale. I agree from the very beginning, but you can also learn as you go and grow with your customers.
And I imagine that when you are going into a new market, you're basically putting your idea to the customers, but also to the competition. Gilles, can you tell us a bit about what the European Patent Office can do to help that kind of thing? Because in a way, I imagine that it helps smooth the way if you can go through an organization like yours, because you can get multiple protections. But are there considerations as well on top of that?
I think that's when you protect your intangible assets and you are looking for a patent or a trademark. Yes, you have to know that if you ask to a nationality to protect your patent, it would be just for this territory. So you are not protected. If you go to Spain and you ask protection with a Spanish patent, you will protect it in Spain, but not in France and not in Portugal. Well, can you live with that? Is it part of your business plan and so on? Fair enough. But if you want to expand, of course, and what is interesting with intellectual property as well is that at a very early stage, we are going to celebrate 150 years of the first international cooperation agreement, facilitating the protection of one invention discovered in one country across different countries. And by the way, it is called the Convention of Paris, 1883. And this convention already put some principles that countries commit to protect and to facilitate the protection, and we were not talking about a digital economy at the time, of course, so it was really a mechanical industry, but from the very beginning they understood we need to make an effort to facilitate the protection of this invention because this is good for the development of the industry and so on. So our organization was created exactly for that purpose. You have a centralized patent granted process. At the EPO, we are 4,000 engineers. We are dealing with 200,000 patent applications per year. Our first customers are American, 25%, and then you have a German, and a Japanese, and China, South Korea, France, and so on. And once a patent is granted, then you can designate any of the 39 EPO member states. But it goes beyond that, because with the same theory, to say, okay, what can we do with some of country partners with us, so which are in the neighboring, for example. So we managed to have an agreement with Morocco, with Tunisia. They accept to recognize a European patent as if it was delivered by the known authority. So you deliver at the EPO, not only you cover Europe in the larger sense, but you can go to Morocco, you can go to Tunisia, you can go to Cambodia, and there are more and more and more to come. So this is one example of what a public authority could do to facilitate. But then, of course, there are also sometimes more technical cooperation between IP offices. We have what we call the IP5, the five biggest IP offices in the world, US, China, Japan, South Korea, and EPO. And we work together to say, okay, what can do to suppress red tape? What can we do to have procedures where an applicant can go through one channel and can spread its applications in all our offices? So this is progressing. It takes some time because some aspects are directly linked to the regulatory framework in one country. It's not easy to change that just for your topic, of course. You touch judicial system. Well, it's different in US, it's different in Europe, so you are never going to change that. But anything we can do at our level, we try to do. So sometimes it's not enough for sure, but this international dimension of intangible asset protection is there in the gene of very beginning.
What other areas should we be considering? You mentioned red tape. What you're describing with the patents, I suppose, isn't quite red tape because you're protecting yourself. But there are legal requirements in every different country, aren't there? What are some of the things that we should be thinking about? And Asa, remember you said something in our pre-panel chat about employment laws, for example. Not something you necessarily think about, but it's really important.
Yeah, exactly. And so obviously this is a European problem mostly. So the way it works is it's not because you have a company in France that you can hire someone in Spain, for example. You have two options. Either you create a full-fledged subsidiary in the country. If you want to employ one person, so let's say you're a salesperson to test the market there, then you may end up spending lots of time and
I'm sorry, but you have really good solutions for that, like deep or remote, etc.
Exactly, so, yeah. And that's what I was touching on. That's option number two, which a lot of companies have done, and that works fine. What I would advise is to read the fine print, because some of these providers have some very tough provisions if you want to let go of some employees. And for example, you may not benefit, a very specific example. In France, if you're a startup losing money, letting go of employees is not that difficult. Because you have small company protections where they give you flexibility. Plus, you're losing money, so you can argue that you're not in a position to keep people just for the sake of keeping people. Now, a lot of these payroll providers in France have a provision that because they themselves are large companies, they do not benefit from this particular area of protection. And so if you go through these companies, you may not benefit from this particular regime if you let go of people. So this is very specific, but I'm sure there are many examples. So read the fine print, ask the right questions. I think it matters matters as well if you go through that route.
And those kind of laws and rules, there'll be a patchwork, won't they, across Europe, different
It's such
area.
A headache. let me allow me to, hopefully anyone in the room, in Europe we have the best people, creative, smart, well-educated, we have the best companies on this planet. But the big companies always come from China and US, and that is one reason and one reason only, because we are not one single market. That's it. If we can solve that, I can tell you as an entrepreneur, it's such a headache to expand across Europe even, let alone having to compete after expanded across Europe with big markets like China and the US. Every country has their own tax laws, has their own employment laws, has their own privacy protection laws, has their own God knows what laws. We are one European Union. Why can't we have one set of laws for every country to abide by? Thank you.
Gilles, you might be able to help us answer that question.
Well, I'm sure I have. Well, I mean, it's fully correct. And we made a study, we published a study last month with a European Investment Bank. And we surveyed 600 companies to understand, especially in Europe, but not only in Europe, what are the main obstacles for you scaling up in Europe and so on. So they mentioned two things. One, to find funding, okay, no surprise. And the other one, the different regulatory frameworks. So they said it's manageable
but
for a big
company. But will come.
Yeah,
the funding,
exactly.
The funding is not the problem.
One is linked to the other, in
yeah,
fact.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's not two dependent things. But of course, what is really... For a big company, they can manage complexity. that there's a big law department, they can pay a specialist expert, but for, it's of course much more difficult for a startup to have the capacity to understand that they are entering into different territories with different rules and so on. It's too complicated, and most of them, they prefer to renounce to that. So this is why they are not scaling up at the level you could expect, even if they are very, very promising. So what we did in our domain, for example, that I explained to you that with one single procedure, you can protect your patent at the EPO. We grant it's one procedure. Potentially can be protected in 99 member states and even more, but then it becomes a national patent. And you have to do all national requirements. So for example, you want to be protected, you have three official languages, English, French, and German. So patent from us is translated in those languages. You go to Hungary, you go to Romania, you go to Laia, you have to translate a full patent, hundreds of pages sometimes, in the local languages. You have to pay to this authority a specific fee in their currency and so on. So it's such a complication that in average, a European patent is validated in 2 to 3 countries. I told you, we give the choice of 39, and 66% of European patents are validated only in 2 to 3 countries. So Germany first, France second, and the UK third position. So we said, okay, let's try to overcome all those barriers. And in Europe, sometimes it takes a lot of time. But when we have finally an agreement, well, there is a capacity to be competitive with the entire world. And this is what we did with a system that has been implemented last year, 1st of June 2023. We started with a new system called Unitary Patent. So it's one single patent covering a territory of 17 countries, 400 million consumer markets. So it's bigger than the US. And you have one single currency, it's euro, which is used there, one single procedure at the EPO. And you know, sometimes when a public authority is devising on the system and you have dreams at the beginning, say, okay, it will make the life of businesses simpler, especially the SMEs, small businesses. Every politician talks about SMEs and so on. Yeah, okay. What is the result of that? That this system is much more used by small businesses, SMEs, and so on. Again, a global company can afford the cost of complexity. You are a big pharma company, you can pay 39 member states fees and so on, not problem. They have a blockbuster, it's a fraction of their cost. But for small businesses, of course, this is a totally different story. So we just now have almost 1 year experience. We have reached a level of transformation of European patent in Unitary Patent, which is at 25%. We expected to reach this level in 2 years. So it's developing much more positively, and from SMEs, 70% of SMEs are validating their European patent with Unitary Patent. So it seems that it works. And what is also extremely important and will make Europe even more competitive than the US is the judicial system, because we created one single judicial system covering all those countries with the same set of rules, same procedures and so on, and with technical judges that will assess your invention and so on. And this is totally new and different. It has been created for the first time. When you go to US, you have a litigation, you have a jury and so on, and God knows what will happen with your patents. So, and the feedback we are receiving from US applicants is that this is really a game changer for Europe, and we have the capacity there to be first in the world. So I fully agree that we have a lot of brains in Europe, a lot of talents. But the problem, of course, is to help and support those businesses to scale up and to develop.
And I know from speaking to you before that all that progress that you made there took years and years. Okay. I was going to ask you guys, do you think that things are better now? Has it become easier in terms of red tape?
So I was told, actually, that the EU last year or 2 years ago, they created a European entity, like so a legal entity for a European company. And I was actually looking for feedback, but I couldn't find any.
Doesn't really work.
Yeah, because, you know, none of my companies are using it, and only a few thousand companies in Europe, I believe, are using it. And so just, you know, it means they're at least trying to aim at the problem. Now, I do believe, you know, getting more feedback to the EU from entrepreneurial representation and lobbying bodies, I think will matter so that they can improve on what they've done, which, to be honest, none of my companies are using, probably because it doesn't help.
So I don't want to be difficult here, but this question too, to me, doesn't make sense. It's not relevant whether it's better or not. The question is it good enough? And the answer to that is no, it's not good enough.
Fair enough. I suppose the thing is, we can't change that on this stage right
Why
now.
Why not?
What we can try, but what we can do is give people here some takeaways. So let's say you've overcome all the difficulties that you've just described, and you've scaled into a new market. What are some of the things that people should be conscious of? Because I know that we talked about company culture and how you export your company culture. We're going to go to questions very soon. I don't think we've got any yet, so please send some questions in on the Slido or get one ready for when I ask for questions. But yeah, let's talk about that. What are some of the things that you need to think about when you are growing in that new market?
Yeah, that's a great question. So Bunk is really big on company culture. Because if you do not think about this, like with anything else, if you don't pay attention to it, it'll grow into this beast that will become a problem later on. I think a part of it is, you know, just a fact of life. A 10-person company is always going to have a different culture than a 10,000-person company. But what we try to do at Bunk is we have created a set of values that are very important, and when we hire, we always make sure, even if a candidate is super fantastic, but if they do not align with those values, we do not hire them.
What kind of values would they be then, just so people know?
So we actually have three. One is ownership, like taking responsibility of the issue that you're overseeing. Two is effective communication, and that's because we're dealing with a lot of different cultures, a lot of different people with different upbringing. We try to communicate in such a way to minimize miscommunications and mistakes. Obviously, we're dealing with people's money, so we don't want to have any mistakes. And the third is data-driven. We hate dogma. We hate, like, I think, or in my experience, those are sentences that we don't like. We want to have sentences like I've heard you say so often today. We looked at the data, this is what we noticed, so we're going to do this, this, and this. Or, hey, we wanted to do this, this, and this. We tried it. Didn't really work because we thought it would be 15, but turns out when you put it to test, it's actually really 12.
So with those values then, it doesn't matter what language people are speaking in or where they're from.
Well, we prefer English for now.
Well, so that's an interesting question. So do you think it's important to have one language that is it across all different branches of the company?
Yes.
Okay. Would you agree with that, Anais?
Yes, and I think that's a good... something that has improved, actually, is that the investor community is a lot more diverse. We have many more international investors now at the early stages investing in many European countries. And it forces everyone to have a working language, usually English. And so having that dynamic from the very beginning of doing the legal documents in English, the processes in English, and just be in the mindset that your emails are going to be, you know, in English as well, really helps. And this is something that has changed a bit.
Definitely. But I do like to add, just because people use the same language, English, doesn't mean they speak it the same way. I think it's a very common example I'd like to use, like when a British person says, that's interesting. Person doesn't mean the same thing as a Dutch person saying, that's interesting. So, you know, there's that too.
Yeah, that's interesting.
So
we have had some questions. We've got 6 minutes left. How would you select a new direction for expansion?
So in addition to what we've said on, you know, looking at the data and be tuned in to the signs you may receive, I think there's something really fun in technology that even though we sell things that we think are very remote, software is a product that can be scaled in many different countries. There are some hubs. So, for example, you find right now in the UK, a lot of the AI companies are targeting financial services, because obviously London is a place where you have most customers in financial services. And so looking at, you know, what you sell and where those hubs are, in different countries, and cities often, it's more granular than countries, is super helpful. So know the hubs, and in the US, for example, there are different hubs within the US for several expertise areas. So knowing these and expanding there first really helps.
And going back to what you said earlier as well, I suppose it's looking out and being nimble and adaptive to where you're seeing your product be used that you weren't expecting as well?
And if you see, so usually and especially for salespeople, salespeople that tend to deliver, I found, are very much well organized. So if you see that your sales guy is a little bit, you know, just not selling a lot, but speaking a lot, for example, that is a sign that potentially this is not the right person, that they're stalling a little bit. So, and these can be transferred, by the way. So, and the same person may sell very well and be very well organized in one market, but then the typical organization steps that you may take in a country, so very specifically. In some countries, things can be seen as pushy, that are seen as less pushy in other cultures. So having someone that knows the right steps and actually delivers, if they don't deliver, it's often that it's just not the right person.
There's another challenge you just mentioned, which we didn't bring up as well. Another question, what bad growth early warning sign can you share? We've kind of had to touch on it a little bit, but can you share some more?
Yeah, well, one of the things I've been doing since I was quite young is I invested in stocks when I was 12. I've always been curious to understand how companies work. And one of the things I've always been very wary of is if revenue grows by X, but losses grow by more than X. And every time I see that, it's usually a super bad indicator of a company that's not going to end well. And when the number of companies exhibiting that issue exceeds a certain threshold, you can foresee actually a crash coming. So in the 2000s, we had the dot-com boom and bust, because you would have these companies that would do 100 million in revenue and then, I don't know, 100 million in loss, and then they would do 150 million in revenue, but then 300 million in loss. That's one of the really good signs. So there is a company from a certain former US president that kind of may exhibit that same pattern. I'm not here to give any investment advice, but you may want to look into that.
I think this one's for you, Gilles, this one. You discussed patents and expansion. What is the best way to scale up in other markets in Europe if you want to protect your tech?
There are different things to consider, because in accompanying development of innovation, you have a lot of countries who are providing specific incentives. So for example, if you file first your patent in France, you will get, if you are a small entities, SMEs and so on, you will get a free reduction, sometimes 50% reduction of your fees. And then you can scale up to Europe, you can go to the EPO in 1 year, as I mentioned. So you do the things in order, and more of those incentives exist in different countries, member states. It exists always in the US with a Small Business Act and so on. So you can combine there specific financial incentives, and then you of course you need to know in which market what are your priorities when you want to develop, where are your competitors. That will help also to make the right decision from the very beginning. And at the EPO, also another things to support small businesses, we decided as of 1st of April this year to make a 30% discount on all the fees for micro entities. So 10 employees maximum, 1 million turnover and so on, because this is at this stage, very early stage, that they need more support. So combine that, combine your commercial perspective with what some countries can offer to support you.
We've got about a minute left. Which role within the company should be responsible for the expansion?
Very quickly, I think usually at some point you want to say send the CEO of the country there.
Obviously, this, especially at early stages, CEO. Once you're as big as Microsoft or whatever, you can have local people, but CEO, founder, everyone.
I would say don't let the lawyers lead your strategy. I'm a lawyer, so I know what I'm talking about. So it's often an issue, because when you reach a stage of protecting your innovation and so on, you have been through all the stages, even sometimes marketing, and then, by the way, we need to protect that. Let's call the lawyers and so on, and this is too late. I would say that these kind of decisions are really strategic and should be, if not the CEO, at the closest circle around the CEO.
That's 10 seconds left. Thank you very much. Thanks for those questions, everybody, and thanks very much for coming and listening. Yep. Gilles, Ali, and Anais. Thank you. Thanks.